Hey Alma, good to see you.
Nice to see you.
I'm so delighted that Stanford Press has given us a chance to sit together for 5 minutes and talk about your new book. And I want to say congratulations on its publication. And I'm holding it here for viewers to see. A wonderful new book by Alma Heckman called The Sultan's Communists, Moroccan Jews, and the Politics of Belonging. Congratulations again.
So much.
And I wanted to give you a chance to kind of step back and both give us a broad but quick overview and maybe let us dive in for a second with a couple of questions about the book.
So the book is, I believe, 10 years in the making at this point, and it dates actually more than that because it dates from the first time I went to Morocco, just after graduating from college. I didn't really know what I was doing, but I had a grant from Fulbright. For some reason, they gave this grant to me to go look at all sorts of Jewish sites across the country. That eventually focused in on me volunteering at the Moroccan Jewish Heritage Museum in Casablanca, where I met this really remarkable figure by the name of Simon Levy. Simon Levy, at the time that I met him, was the director of the museum, but I learned through discussions with him over the time that I was there that he had been a very prominent member of the Moroccan Communist Party and had been very active in national liberation politics and in anti-Zionist politics as well among Moroccan Jews and nationally. And I started asking myself how exceptional of a character he was. I'd never heard of a story like his before. And so then when I went to grad school, I thought about writing a dissertation that really focused on this person and putting him in the broader Moroccan national and Jewish historical context. And that's ultimately, what led to this book, to figures like Simon Levy and others like him, and thinking about what they could tell us about the history of Moroccan Jews, both across the 20th century and more critically after the moment of independence in 1956, right? That there was still a thriving Jewish community in Morocco that was still very politically engaged, and that the story doesn't end with just mass migration in the 1950s and 1960s.
Yeah, it's striking to me that this character in particular, but so many of them are people driven by passion, by political passion. And in some ways, in your beautiful telling of their histories, their passion makes them idiosyncratic. And sometimes they're quite cantankerous. And yet, as you present it to us, their political journeys and activism also allows us to step back and look at this extraordinary, really nearly century-long in your telling arc of Moroccan Jewish history, not only from within the communist circles, but much, much more broadly. So I don't know if that toggle between the individual and the it's national, but it's also multi-transnational and personal, if that toggling between registers is something that you sought to pursue.
Definitely. I mean, I'm always very interested in personal stories and what individual stories can say about the world around them, how you can follow a character, so to speak, or a historical figure. And even if they're totally idiosyncratic, right? I mean, the people I'm writing about are minorities of minorities of minorities in so many ways. The vast majority of Moroccan Jews were not very politically active in no part of the time period I'm discussing. And most of them, if they were politically active, were part of the Moroccan Communist Party, but the vast majority of the community really shunned the figures that I write about. However, and most Moroccan nationalists, Jewish or otherwise, were not communists. So it's so circles within circles of minority affiliations. However, it's from looking at these minority figures and their personal stories that we can see how they are embedded in broader social communities, religious communities, and all kinds of political communities. And it's in fact that kind of antagonism that somebody like Simon Levy shows, right? Why is it that people, when I first went to Morocco, I would tell Jews in the community, okay, I'm looking at these Moroccan Jewish communists. And so many of them would say, why do you care about them? They're not the whole story. But the thing is, their ardent rejection of these figures is part of the total story. Why did they elicit such strong reactions? And the thing is, the
And
number.
shame, and also they're taboo. It's not even a strong reaction. They become taboo figures.
Yes, liabilities, right? They become liabilities to the Jewish community, first because they represent, under French colonial rule and Spanish colonial rule, they represent people that are opposition to the colonial powers and maybe shed a bad light on the broader Jewish community and their supposed loyalties to those colonial overlords. And then after independence, because they function as an opposition force against the monarchy, it's after independence, but they're still, I mean, they're loyal to the Moroccan state, but they're still pushing for quite a bit of reform that lands almost all of them in prison and tortured at various intervals of their lives. And the wider Moroccan Jewish community isn't particularly concerned with their fate. It's more of an international human rights community that's very concerned with what's taking place with them.
Yeah, wonderful. Well, our time is short and has alas come to an end, but I want to again congratulate you on this beautiful book, The Sultan's Communists, and encourage readers out there who are interested in histories of politics, histories of radicalism, a micro history, but also a very ambitious exploration of modern Morocco and modern Moroccan Jewry as seen through this, as you say, multiply marginalized, but also incredibly resonant political community. I urge all of you to rush out and buy a copy of Alma Heckman's The Sultan's Communists. And I wanna again congratulate you so much on this wonderful book.
Thank you so much.
Great to talk to you, Alma. Stay healthy.
Thank you.
Bye.